Good evening. My name is Devin Walker, and I'm the director of the Heman Sweat Center for Black Males, as well as the Center for Global Leadership and Social Impact within the Division of Diversity and Community Engagement. It is my pleasure to welcome you all here today to the 2022 Heman Sweat Center Symposium. So I will be your MC for the evening, and I'm super excited to really just to be here with, in community with you all as we explore what intentional solidarity can look like and should look like. Before we get into that, I want to play a little audio clip that brings us into a little bit of the history of why we're here today.
The start of the new era at Texas was marked on February 26, 1946, when a man named Heman Marion Sweat applied for admission to the University of Texas School of Law. Sweat was a postman who wanted to be a lawyer. He met the academic requirements. His educational background included a BA from Wiley College in 1934 and 12 semester hours of graduate work at the University of Michigan in 1937. In this way, he did not differ from many of the other applicants, but he was denied admission to the university's law school. Heman Marion Sweat was black. That denial of admission had greater impact than all the admissions granted that semester. It led to one step, then another, and another, each in turn leading to progress in education, in human rights, in racial integration, and in the University of Texas itself. Many changes have taken place in the decades that followed, some slow, some dramatic, and some passing almost unnoticed. They began when Heman Sweat refused to accept the denial of his application to attend law school at the University of Texas.
Good evening. Good evening. Thank you, Malik. The audio we just heard is from Chapter 1 of Overcoming, the first history of desegregation at UT Austin, written by the beloved Almetris Marsh Duran and UT staff member Louise Isco in 1979. It was read by Ms. Brenda Burt. Both Almetris Duran and Brenda Burt played major roles in supporting and advocating for black students at UT. The legacy of Heman Marion Sweat lives on in this annual symposium, which was started by students in 1985 to discuss contemporary civil rights issues. Sweat's legacy also lives on to the Sweat Center. I am Donovan Handy, president of the Heman Sweat Center for Black Males. Thank you, thank you, thank you. Honestly and truly, I would not be standing before you were it not for the Sweat Center. Being able to find a group of black males, successful ones at that, on this PWI's campus was inconceivably important for me. With sweat comes opportunity. Last spring, I went on an exposure and sustainability trip to Dubai. Last summer, many of our brothers studied abroad in Cape Town, South Africa. Next month, a group of brothers and I will be going on a selective trip to Ghana. This is all sponsored by the Heman Sweat Center and our lovely Dr. Walker here in the front row. This is all also not to mention the countless power hours, transformative retreats, expansive network, and beautiful community that exists within the center. With Sweat, I have legitimately laughed, cried, succeeded, and failed. Without a shred of a doubt, the Heman Sweat Center, the direct legacy of my dear predecessor, Heman Sweat himself, has made my undergraduate career exactly what it has been. Wonderful. Though, enough about me. I am honored to introduce someone who has dedicated her career to the University of Texas at Austin, Dr. Latoya Smith, Vice President for Diversity and Community Engagement. She is a lifelong Longhorn. She earned both her bachelor's degree and her doctorate from UT Austin. Dr. Smith was named Vice President in December of 2020, where she recently led the creation of a new 3-year strategic diversity, equity, and inclusion plan for the university that is called You Belong Here. Please join me in welcoming Dr. Smith.
Well, Well, thank you, Donovan, for that wonderful introduction. You truly do epitomize why what we do here matters at this university. Like Dr. Walker, I want to say good evening to you all. We are so pleased that you could join us this evening as we honor and have an annual event that honors and pays homage to one of the civil rights pioneers at the University of Texas at Austin. But before we get into the program, I would like to thank our many campus sponsors and our corporate sponsor tonight, Netspend. Because of their generosity, we wouldn't be able to put this program on tonight. Now, for nearly 40 years, students, faculty, staff, and community members have gathered for the annual Heman Sweat Symposium for Civil Rights. Each year is marked by a new theme based on current issues or topics in civil rights. And in America, civil rights is always evolving. Some years, we may move forward 2 steps, back 3, or vice versa. The pendulum is always shifting. And despite those swings of the pendulum, it's important to remember that the civil rights movement and the resulting Civil Rights Act of 1964 paved the way for so much more than just desegregation in this country. It led to the Voting Rights Act the same year and helped shape a more liberal immigration policy that essentially changed the face of our nation. Tonight, we are gathered here together to reflect on our history and to talk about our future. History shows that when we find ourselves entrenched in different positions, pitted against one another in an effort to tamp down progress. But history also shows us that when we work together and we think intentionally about solidarity, what can happen? Martin Luther King Jr. drew inspiration from Gandhi's idea of nonviolent direct action to create something that was defining and created the events of the civil rights era. And in turn, the civil rights era saw coordinated solidarity and activism from people across the spectrum in America. From Cesar Chavez that led labor strikes across the Southwest and collaborated with Filipino American workers and the Delano grape strike. Leaders of the Chicano rights movement, the American Indian movement, and Asian American activists like Yuri Cochiyama worked alongside civil rights leaders and Black Power leaders. And with their efforts, their solidarity, they were able to make movements, real change in their communities. And so tonight, we celebrate the diversity that is a vital component to the success of this university and this nation. Tonight, we will discuss the significance of cross-cultural unity and how we form allyships for progress and how we can work with different people with different ideologies for the greater good. And especially in a time when there is so much divisiveness and so much political turmoil, these strategies and skills are important for our unity as a nation and our community. Now, before I hand it over to our panel discussion, I'd like to introduce one of our community partners, Netspend. As a local corporation, Netspend is committed to diversity, equity, and inclusion and supports the division by funding some lectures like these tonight, as well as providing student scholarships so that they can travel abroad. And on behalf of Netspend, I would like to welcome Ms. Olabeti Moultrie, the Automated Clearinghouse Operations Senior Manager for Netspend. Ms. Moultrie?
So I'm a little shorter, I gotta bring this down. Just a little bit. Am I even above the podium? How y'all doing? Y'all got a step stool? So first, number one, it is absolutely an honor to be here to speak on behalf of Netspend. A lot of people, when we say Netspend, they say, what's Netspend? What is that? Well, we're the face behind so many cards and things that you use prepaid. If you've done HEB, PayPal, Brinks, that's Netspend. So we're the face behind. And one of the things I like to say about that is that Netspend doesn't mind not having its name out there in bright lights. We do things behind doors. And behind our doors in Netspend, one of the things I love about our company, about the opportunity to fund and to promote beautiful causes like this, this transformational unity, is Netspend thrives on diversity. I am a living representation of diversity in Netspend. My voice is heard. Our culture in Netspend, when people ask, "Hey, where do you work?" Some people are very like, "Oh, I work here, and you know, it's okay." What happens in your company? What do you like about it? Well, you know, we have insurance and some stuff like that. Well, not in Netspend. We have family and culture and diversity that's so deep. Every culture gets represented at every time of the year. I get to have my voice heard in how we present our product and what we show to the world. And that's the difference in Netspend that I love. And that's why Netspend is so deeply ingrained in supporting intentional, and I love the word intentional causes that really promote cross-cultural unity. We are intentional in where we spend our funds. We're intentional in who we bring into the company. We're intentional about the things that we do with our product and our product line. And that's what I love about this cause. So I'm excited to hear the amazing speakers and the amazing panels that we're going to have tonight, because that intentional cause, that purpose to really bring those cultures together, to find out that you can't move the gap from just one side. You got to bring the other side in. So everybody is moving. That's what I want to see today. And I'm so excited to be here to hear this panel. And next time, bring me a stool.
I think you got it right perfect for me, actually. We in this together. It's perfect. So thank you, Ms. Moultrie, for being here with us. Thank you, Netspend, for your generous donation. And next up, we have a really exciting act. We have some spoken word poetry. Y'all ready for some spoken word poetry? We hear a little noise? All right, so just by a show of hands, how many of y'all have been to a spoken word poetry event? All right, most of us. So for those who haven't, I just want to encourage you, if you hear something you like, if something really sticks to your heart, go ahead and make some noise, some snaps. All right, the artists love that. They thrive off of that, all right? So I want to introduce, we have three spoken word poets. We have Caleb Smith, who's a senior in the College of Education. We have Trinity Dow, who's a sophomore in the College of Liberal Arts. And we have Rosa Elisa, who's a community leader and activist. So please put your hands together and make some noise for our poets.
How do we become unified amongst different cultures? It starts by sharing stories, seeing where we overlap as underdogs, seeing what we underwent as overcomers. In this poem, we will share stories from Black and Brown perspectives. While this is a formal event, clap or give a holler if you relate to any of these stories. The snapping stuff's cool, but you know, I like the feedback. As relating is the foundation of us becoming a unified people. Understand, Black don't crack. My mama getting up there in age with grace. Understand, she don't look it. Her looks explain how I still rock my baby face. Baby, Black don't crack, baby. Black don't crack, we earthquake. Booty shake to grooves we make. Can't predict our moves like tsunami wave, because if you ain't know, Black time is always late, but Black rhythm is always on time. Black don't crack, we moisturizing. Cause getting caught with dry skin be traumatizing. Cocoa butter and shea wet, I confide in when those winter days be choosing violence.
Brown don't frown.
Brown don't frown, it bites. Tequila y navajas, it fights. Dirty when life's on the line, passion fueled love and war. Setting ourselves ablaze, si se vale la pena. Brown don't frown, it shares. It's everyone is family when we all sit together, feasting on laughter. Compas and tías that aren't really tías, but love you like so. Brown don't frown, like the African roots in our salsa, cumbia, y bachatas. The way freedom and joy rolls through our body, our liberations so closely entwined.
Black don't crack. Black don't crack like dad, brand new work boots, the sturdiest of work shoes. Built to last long enough to pass on to the next railroad dad. Protecting his feet from the heat and piercing up the rocks like a thug to his Glock. Black don't crack. Black don't crack like grandmama, indestructible faith. Through her eyes, I see God in all of the ways we always protected. When mama prays and the way her light shines, it steals pride in our spines. Black don't crack. Black don't crack like that one note my cuz hit at the family function. Carrying our souls out of confusion and destruction. Every word containing a message or instruction. Like the freedom songs in the 60s. The same tunes that constructed our history.
Black and brown identities.
Different yet synonymous.
Brown frown like...
Brown frown like the callus in Miapa's hands from working the caña or picking the fruit.
Vegetarians claim is cruelty-free.
As if it's not the cruelest thing that he can't afford the same food he puts on your table. Buckets of sweat priced at pennies and dimes.
Black crack like crack of dawn, waking up to what the work do. Lacing up them work shoes, on the job by 6, off at 2, then another 8-hour shift.
Brown like learning 100 civic questions, waiting 40 years in line, only to forget the American tradition of voter suppression.
Registration legislation
that's constantly changing, hoping the House votes to keep us around.
Black crack like
my friends, homeboys, cousin did in that interrogation room. He was on his third strike. They was trying to give him life. And the last time he was locked up, the relationship with his son,
sacrifice.
So his forehead sweating, hands shaking, legs trembling. We all knew he would fold. They gave his cousin a dime and let him go free. But last week he was found. 3 shots to his back and 2 to his knee. Now one son is lost to the sword and the other to the system.
Both victims. Brown frown like.
Don't stay out too late at night or too long in the sun. Ama reassures, this is for our protection.
Black crack like roach entryways. Black crack like busted pipes, leaky ceilings in Section 8 housing. Black crack like leave the window open, AC don't work here. Black crack like leave the oven on, the only heater that works is the policeman's gun. Brown frown like
being fed a whitewashed history, but learning hours online, in electives, in our own spare time. The shaman, oh, you don't speak Spanish? As if this wasn't the colonizer's tongue still stuck between our teeth.
Black crack like a black woman's voice after centuries of being silenced or wrongfully accused of being defiant or violent or lacking guidance, mislabeled, misguided. Her monotone melody used to be a serenading shout. Her once voluminous voice now a hesitant harmony.
Black don't crack. Brown don't frown. Can't age children of God. We went to hell and back, facing the fire like
you can't take this youth away.
And regardless of who appropriates, they can't take the truth away.
They can't get down like us.
Because they ain't been down like us.
Despite a history of hardships, black and brown tend to never age, almost as if we got back youth as wage for all of the work that went unpaid.
It's still crazy hearing traumatic slave stories or what the ancestors did for me, counting what they overcame, even if the blessing there was making it another day. I pray we make it another day.
Black and brown still making it another day. We grind.
We shine.
These peaks.
We climb.
Our kind.
Divine.
Your plight is mine.
All right, we got to make some more noise for Caleb, Trinity, and Rita. Come on now. That was sensational. I intentionally didn't listen to them practice because I knew they were going to blow me away. All right, so at this point, I'm super excited. It is my honor to introduce our esteemed panelists, all of whom I've had the unique pleasure of working with at some point in my career. Dr. Liu currently serves as the Associate Dean of Diversity and Inclusion at Johns Hopkins University. Prior to arriving at Johns Hopkins, he led cross-functional efforts in student success, strategic initiatives, organizational change, and justice, equity, diversity, and inclusion at UC San Diego and also here at UT Austin. Over the years, Dr. Liu has served as an educational researcher, a consultant, a school director, an academic coach, and a middle school science teacher, where he was the recipient of the Toyota International Teacher of the Year Award. With that award, he created a virtual curriculum on environmental sustainability in the Galapagos Islands. He is a proud alumnus of several other notable programs, including Education Pioneers, the U.S. State Department's Fulbright Program, and the Asian Pacific American Institute of Congressional Studies National Leadership Academy. Dr. Liu earned his PhD in Higher Education Administration from the University of Texas at Austin. Tamara Craver is President and Chief Executive Officer of Reality Changers. She is a 2022 recipient of the San Diego Business Journal's CEO of the Year Award, and she has more than 20 years of experience in nonprofit management, executive leadership, and youth development. Ms. Craver is a passionate advocate for first-generation college students and educational equity. Prior to joining Reality Changers, Ms. Craver served as the director of the Posse Foundation, director of development and communications for the Torrance South Bay YMCA, and director of social markets for the American Heart Association. Ms. Craver is actively involved in the community, serving on the boards of LEAD San Diego and San Diego Squared, as well as the Advisory Council for San Diego Foundation Black Community Investment Fund. She is a member of the San Diego Rotary Club 33 and executive committee chairperson of the Hoover Community Collaborative. Dr. Emmett Campos is the director of Project Males and the Texas Education Consortium for Male Students of Color. He oversees three cross-cultural and interrelated initiatives that make up Project Males. First, a research institute focused on understanding the experiences of Latinx males across the educational pipeline. Second, a statewide consortium of diverse K-12 and higher education institutions committed to dramatically increasing student success for male students of color in the state of Texas. And third, the Project Males Mentoring Program, a school-based peer and near-peer mentoring program that engages and empowers middle and high school men of color across Central Texas and serves as a model for other school-based mentoring programs across Texas. Dr. Campos has an extensive history of service in the Austin community and has taught at UT Austin, St. Edward's University, and Austin Community College. Dr. Campos spent his undergraduate years at the University of Wisconsin-Madison, where he was introduced to Black Studies and Chicano Studies and participated in Black, Native American, and Latinx solidarity work in the 70s and 80s, preparing him for his current research and teaching here at UT. He earned his PhD in Cultural Studies in Education and Curriculum and Instruction from UT Austin. Please give me a huge round of applause and welcome our three panelists.
Yeah. You got metal, yeah? Hmm? You got metal? Mm-hmm.
We can barely make out the audience from here, right? The lights are quite bright. So thank you so much, Devin, for that introduction. And thank you, everybody, for joining us for this panel. Welcome, Charles and Tamara, to Austin. Welcome to UT, and welcome to our panel. And I appreciate you taking the time to share a little bit about your story. We had lunch today at the Carillon, and so we talked a little bit about our conversation today. And I wanted to start by, first of all, the format is we're going to go about 25 or 30 minutes. We're going to have a conversation. I've got about three or four questions prepared, and then we're going to open it up to the audience and have a conversation, because we want the audience, of course, to participate in this conversation as well, in the dialogue with our panelists. So we want to leave ample time for that, about 10 minutes or so. So I'm going to start with the first question, all right, if I may. And I'm going to have you talk about your current work. But before we do that, I wanted to ask you about what your experience, whether it's academic, your cultural upbringing, and maybe any studies, any research that you've done that might get you to this point. And so I'll ask you, and I'll ask it in this way. Describe your personal and professional trajectory and how your cultural upbringing, your studies, your professional work in forging cross-cultural unity and solidarity work impact the work you do now in this space. And so maybe you can kind of go back and tell us how you landed here at Realities Changes. I'm going to ask you to start, and then I'll turn to Dr. Liu.
So I would start with, I feel like this was probably predestined for me in a sort of way. Just to kind of give a little bit of background for myself is that my great-great-great-grandfather was born at the end of the institution of slavery, but when he passed away, he was a college professor. So in our family, it wasn't about, if, it was just where you were going to go to college. And my grandmother, unfortunately, during the Depression, was not able to attend college. So she worked two jobs along with my grandfather to make sure that my mother went to college. So that feeling of first-generation student has always stuck with me. Mm-hmm. And what it was like for us to attend college, knowing that my grandmother did not have the opportunity to attend. So I take that very seriously about higher education, equal access to education. And so I feel like every job I've ever had in some way has prepared me for this next step to be the president and CEO of a nonprofit that focuses on serving first-generation students to become college graduates and agents of change in their community. So in a way, I feel like I was created for this. Not to sound too cocky, but when I read the job description, I was like, yeah, that's it. That's me. And just to be able to do my heart work every day into pouring into students and creating spaces for them to have a voice in those rooms. And, people have talked about having a seat at the table, but we're talking about building tables, building the room that these conversations are in. And so just to know that I have a very small part in that is literally why I get up every day and do this type of work.
Great. So that sounds a little bit like my trajectory, mm-hmm. right? Landing kind of an ideal job that I have as director of Project Mills. Fortunate enough to join them about 8 years ago. And everything I did kind of led to, right. to this position. And so it's really a great opportunity for me to be able to work in this space. And it sounds like it is for you as well.
Thank you.
Charles, tell me your story. Before you landed at Johns Hopkins, I know you were in California. Yep. And then before that, of course, we crossed paths, right, at DDCE. And talk a little bit about maybe how all that experience and your studies in the higher ed program, how that prepared you for the work that you're doing now in light of our topic today, right?
Yeah, so first off, it's great to be back walking campus. It's been a minute since I've been here, so it's great to see so many familiar faces and colleagues here at UT. I actually once called myself a three-time Longhorn, and I got made fun of because I was like, yeah, I did my undergrad here, I did my grad, and I worked here. And they were like, yeah, when you work here, that doesn't count. You're here. So my story, I like to think of a movie that came out in the early 2000s called Spanglish. If any of you all have ever seen that movie before, and throughout the course of the movie, but there's one particular scene where there's this young girl from Mexico who is constantly translating for her mother, right? And that was literally my experience. That was me. I was the first person in my entire extended family to be born in the US. Mm. I grew up speaking Mandarin until the age of 4, and that's when I learned English. And that really shaped my particular experience because I saw the way that folks would treat me who could speak English pretty fluently versus someone like my mother or my father mm-hmm. who spoke with an accent. And it became very apparent, like even small interactions, right? The level of patience that folks would have, the tone that they would take mm-hmm. with certain folks, the way that they would speak to my parents just because of their language accessibility was completely different from the way that they would speak to me, even as a child, right? Growing up, mm-hmm. 7 and 8, translating for my parents in a supermarket. And so, to me, just from a very young age, I saw what language can do for folks. And many folks come from immigrant backgrounds, so a lot of folks can relate to the story. But to me, it's not only just about the type of language that you speak, but also it's about voice.
Right.
Right? Because there's a lot of folks that speak English fluently in the U.S., but the U.S. has historically and systematically excluded folks who have different levels of voice, mm-hmm. right? Some people are able to get across a little bit more, some people have the connections, and other folks don't. And so, to me, that level of injustice and disparity is why I got into this work. As a tiny boy, being 7 and 8, translating for my parents in a supermarket to now being an associate dean at Hopkins, the work remains similar, because at the end of the day, we don't have equity, right. and we don't have equality, and there's still injustice going on. And so for me, a lot of it is about giving voice to my students. In my current role, I oversee our 5,000 students, undergraduate students, and 20,000 graduate students over at Hopkins. And so one of the pieces that I love is that language consistently changes, it consistently evolves. Values continue to evolve as well. And so I'm just excited to be a part of that journey on behalf of our students.
Great, great. And you know, that experience that you were describing about those linguistic challenges that your parents face, right? We see that played out with a lot of the young men that we work with, right? We work with young men, middle and high school young men in East Austin. And a lot of our Latinx young men also operate in that kind of space, right? Having to translate for their parents, right? Faced with some of those challenges. They get plugged into either bilingual ed programs that really don't work for them. But I like how you pointed out that there was some agency in the experience that you had, right, as a young man translating for your parents. And so we remind these young men that they are translators as well, right, for their parents in that space, even though the challenges that their parents face, right, not having a voice or not having the language to be able to successfully navigate in this space, right? And so I'm glad you brought that up. Again, similar kind of trajectories to a lot of the young men that we work with as well. Thanks for sharing that. So you were beginning to describe a little bit about the work that you do at Johns Hopkins, and so that kind of leads me to the next question. Can you share a little bit about the work that you do now in your position as associate dean, as exec director? Talk a little bit about that work and how you work in that space to forge these cross-cultural the solidarity work that we're talking about now on this panel. Talk a little bit about how you do that work. You know, you're in San Diego, mm-hmm. and my next question is going to talk about those transnational kinds of alliances that you built, and you shared a little bit about that work that you do. But talk about how you're doing that work in San Diego and California, and some of the communities that you're bringing together to do that work. And I'll let either one of you start with that answer, Charles or Tomer.
Okay. Sorry, can you hear? Okay, perfect. I was told that my mic wasn't working, so I'm glad that it works. So in my current role as associate dean over at Hopkins, so serve 5,000 undergrad students, 20,000 graduate students over at Hopkins. It's a little bit different, especially being at UT. Before Hopkins, I also worked at UC San Diego, so I worked at two pretty large public schools. And so we really had a lot more undergraduate students than graduate students. The question was about solidarity and cross-cultural unity and how that's been a part of my role. So I'll actually give a very specific example. One of the things that we've been dealing with over at Hopkins, and it's pretty interesting because at UT and at UC San Diego, when I arrived on those campuses, there was already a police department, right? So there was UTPD and there was UCPD. Hopkins didn't have one. And if you know anything about Baltimore, you'll know that that particular city has a lot of racial tension, specifically with police, right? With policing and the community. And so basically what happened was that Hopkins has created a Johns Hopkins Police Department that was not particularly palatable to a lot of the community members and a lot of students on campus. So I, in my role, advise a number of different organizations. We have 80 plus student organizations that report up to my center, including Multicultural Affairs, Gender and Sexuality Resources, and Religious and Spiritual Life. So I was in a conversation with the Inter-Asian Council, and the president of the Inter-Asian Council was like, yo, Dean Liu, like one of the things that we're really trying to work on this year is that we want to have a voice. As Asian folks, we're oftentimes silenced. As Asian folks, we're oftentimes invisible. We're sick of it, and we want to stand up and be heard. And I was like, okay, dope. So what do y'all want to talk about, right? Like, what do y'all want to be known for? And the president basically said, well, yeah, we want to increase our advocacy, but we don't know how to do it. And I said, okay, cool. So what are your peers talking about, right? Like, y'all are on a multicultural leadership council. You meet with the Black Student Union, you meet with Olay, you meet with the Indigenous Student Group. What are other student groups talking about? And they were like, well, they're talking about the JHPD. And I was like, okay, dope. So what does the IACC feel about the JHPD? And they said, well, the majority of our students are not about the JHPD. Like, we staunchly oppose it. And I said, okay, cool. So have you talked to the BSU? Have you talked to Olay? And they were like, no. And it was really interesting to me, right? Because they literally come together every month as a multicultural leadership council. And they have agenda items, but they had never talked about this particular issue. And so all I said was like, look, why don't you go ahead and talk to the leaders of those various organizations? Because coming together in solidarity is so much more powerful, right? The administration already knows that the BSU opposes the JHPD. They've made it very clear. Where's Olay at? Where's the IAC at? Where's the Indigenous Council at, right? Because they don't know. And if they don't know, then that's a problem because they assume that you're okay with it. And in my role as dean, like, let's just be real and honest, right? Like, I represent the university, so I have to be very careful about what I'm able to say. So I'm not telling, so in my conversation with IAC, I said, I'm not telling you to go out and necessarily oppose it, but I'm telling you that it helps to be in solidarity with other folks that you're in council with and make your voices heard, because this should not only be a BSU issue, because policing is not only a Black issue. It also affects all the other communities, and you in various ways, specifically you all as Asians and Asian Americans in this particular way, right? And so the IAC took that. They actually went back together with the Multicultural Leadership Council and then, you know, had a conversation with the vice president of campus safety. But without that encouragement, I don't know if the IAC would have been able to vocalize, you know, how they felt about the JHPD. And frankly, administration never would have known. And it would have been this cycle of invisibility and, you know, feeling like you lack a voice when you didn't even put yourself out there in the first place.
Great. Well, thank you for sharing that story. You know, giving us a case example of an initiative, an issue that you had to deal with and stuff. So maybe you can also share, Tamara, maybe share an anecdote or a story about how you brought together communities in San Diego, Black, Brown, Asian, Pacific Islander, Native American. Can you talk a little bit about maybe some of that work and,
sure.
and maybe give us an example
yes.
of how that happened?
So in the community that I serve, when I talk about first generation, we're talking about a very immigrant community. East African that have come to this country under different reasons. So the community changes every couple of years based on what's happening in the world. So we have a very strong Latino community, and then we have this very strong East African community. And now we're seeing people coming in from the most recent war-torn areas. So it constantly is evolving. And the challenges with that is that the pandemic hit that community in a very different way. We had students who were supposed to be doing classwork online that were dialing in but at work for their parents because their parents were sick with COVID. We had students that were picking up extra jobs to help with their families. I have a student whose almost entire family died because of COVID.
Wow.
And so when you talk about being new to this country, and maybe your parents came here for whatever, however they came to this country, these students that I'm dealing are dealing with different issues on a regular basis. Being afraid of ISIS, I mean, like, it's a very real thing. A lot of my students are technically undocumented students, so the fear that they have faced during the pandemic has been challenging. So online learning for students was already hard for any student. When you talk about students that are brand new to this country, dealing with language barriers, cultural barriers, online was like a death sentence for them. So when they say that the average student is about 3 semesters behind, some of my students are basically like 3 years behind academically. So the kind of partnerships and community building that we have to do is a little bit different. So I said earlier, you know, every university wants first generation students. When they look at their admissions, they want them. And I think as my job as president and CEO of a nonprofit that focuses on first gen is to push back, is to push the envelope and say, you may want them, but are you prepared to serve them? when they're there? Are you going to handhold through to graduation? It is not enough just to say your numbers are 20% of this demographic. That's no longer acceptable. So I see my role also as pushing the envelope. It's to make people uncomfortable, to say, great, now I gave you these students, what are you gonna do for them now? And people dislike that sometimes, and it's okay. But this is the only way we're gonna move that needle a little bit, is if we push the envelope that it has to look different. I know in my previous organization, a lot of universities did not have remedial. We gotta look at things a little bit different. That pandemic has set these students back. And if we don't fix that, this is forever gonna create a difference between the haves and the have-nots, if we don't fix that unfortunate period in time. So some of the things that we're doing is looking at mentorship is probably one of the most pivotal things for our students. And often, you know, people come with good intentions, but it also matters when mentors come and they look like the students that we represent. Because it's hard when they just can't identify with what you're even referring to. It has to be, I get it, I've been there, I've understood. But that's why this is so, higher education is so important. We need more of our students to be educated with these degrees so they can come back to the communities and say, each one teach one, it's my responsibility to pull another one up. And that has to happen, I think. So looking at those partnerships, and also, I live in San Diego. It's a border city. We're right there. And so one of the things we're also doing is how we work differently with Mexico. You know, when the pandemic hit, I was very glad to say that we were able to account for every single one of our students within 24 hours, even the students who live across the border. A lot of my students come across the border every single day to go to school. So which that meant some of them got stuck in San Diego without their family, and some got stuck in Mexico. So we were able to account for every single student and help support them as much as we humanly could. And as anyone else knows, that safer at home did not mean safer at home for everybody. So we also, because of our work with community agencies and county agencies, had good relationships with the families in that they trusted us to come by and, well, we call them, California, drive-bys. We would just drive by the student's house and drop off peanut butter and bread, and it was really our way to put eyes on the student to make sure that they were okay. So building these relationships with Mexico is huge for us because, again, they also want to support their students, and we talked about, you know, these detention centers. We got to get rid of all of that stuff. And working different with Mexico is going to be monumental. So right now we're working in partnership. I've been able to be a co-creator with Central Fox, which is the presidential library of former President Vicente Fox. I'm a huge fan of him, and more importantly, a fan of the work that he's doing, that he's so committed to, now that no longer that he's president, that he's insisting on that there be change in the educational system in Mexico. And he's like, I want our kids back. The students that have gone to the U.S., he was like, we want to create an environment for them to come back and change Mexico. So to be able to be a part of that, I feel like, as I talked about, this was what I felt like I was destined for, is to create those bridges between the two communities.
Yeah, and we're already moving into question three, because I did want you to share a little bit about that powerful relationship and collaboration that you're talking about, transnational collaboration. But I also, before we move there, I wanted to point out that this partnership that you forged with the higher ed institutions, right? I think that is critical work that needs to be done. The university can't do it alone, in the same way that our school districts can't do it alone. So when we step into that space to provide mentorship, it's to support the counselors and the teachers and the principals there that need that help. So it's really heartening to hear that you've been working with those universities to be able to deliver and support our first gen, because we have, we face some of those very same issues with our first gen students here. And now that we're HSI, we have to really step it up. We have to step up our game and really be a truly serving institution and not just in numbers only. Mm-hmm. And so, and there's a lot of other things that you said, the mentorship thing, that's right on, right? Because we understand that these young men can identify with people that come from shared experiences and they look like them, and they can build those relationships much quicker than somebody that maybe is not connected to that background and history. So moving to question three, I wanted to ask you to talk a little bit more about that transnational collaboration and work. So That was news to me when we met at lunch today about this. You asked me, do you know Vicente Fox? I go, the Vicente Fox? Yes. Yes, indeed.
Yes.
We know him, and so it's wonderful. Can you share a little bit maybe about that work that you're doing with them? And maybe we can learn from that experience.
Yes.
Because, you know, we have a pretty strong, Devin Walker leads a pretty strong study abroad program,
yes,
right? We're always looking at forging alliances across countries, right? China,
absolutely,
South Africa, Mexico. So talk a little bit about that work, and maybe that could be a model for some of the work that we're doing in Mexico,
yes,
through our Maymester program.
I love it. So there's been a partnership that has been brewing for a few years between the organization and in partnership with UC San Diego. And when I came 3 years ago, right before I came, there used to be a very robust study abroad program between our students coming from Reality Changers in San Diego going to Mexico for a week, and then vice versa. They'd all come back and do a program together at UC San Diego. Of course, pandemic happened, all that went away. Now it's been very challenging to get the students in Mexico visas to come back over and do their program at UC San Diego. So we've been working with the president and his team to strengthen these relationships, but more importantly, not just the study abroad piece, but it is huge to think about in high school to be able to do a study abroad program in Mexico where you can go for two weeks and meet a family, hang out with some new friends, come back, and you all go do an educational program together. But we're also looking at, again, just creating a community where it's okay to be from Mexico. And I think sometimes in San Diego, students are taught to don't talk about it, don't tell anybody that you're first gen. And like, no, it's okay to be first gen. It's applauded, it's supported. And now working with the former president and his team is like building that bridge that we can also bring companies and businesses and universities in to say, you can also be a part of this. Like, I think I love as a former president that he is spending so much time with his community still and focusing on education, because he always says, like, if we don't change the educational system in Mexico, they're going to continue to leave this wonderful country. So building these bridges between the two organizations, the universities, and bringing other organizations. So we'd love to talk to you later about it, how to get involved. But it's UC San Diego now has a satellite office there. And I think one of the beautiful things is the students that went through the program before, through the Central Fox program, are now the professors that are teaching us. So the students are being paid at the same rate in Mexico as a professor at UC San Diego, which you're talking about leveling the playing field. But again, these are students that went through that program years ago. So now it's taking it to the next level, that now they're the professor. So we're not coming in that we're going to save anybody. No, how do we build up the community so they can do it for themselves and with themselves? And so I think that's something that I take great pride in, that we're going to continue with this model. And I think it's untapped potential to continue to work with Mexico.
Sounds great. And we will be checking in with you about expanding our program, Maymester in Puebla. Can Charles talk a little bit about that, about your work forging this cross-cultural, cross-collaborative unity across maybe U.S., Mexico, or elsewhere?
Sure. So I think I'm going to hop on the UC San Diego bandwagon just for a sec, because I also worked there prior to being at Hopkins, right? And so while I was there, I was part of the Chicanx Latinx Academic Excellence Initiative. And a big part of it was, at that time, we were teetering on becoming a Hispanic-serving institution, right? So we were like not quite there at that number or the threshold. But I think a big part of it was that we had Latino leaders that were very much so adamant about us being ready, right? Like you said, that we were ready to be a Hispanic-serving institution. And it wasn't just like we became HSI and it's like, okay, surprise, like let's get ready for them, right? And so I know a number of the things that UC San Diego did when I was there was actually really ramp up their marketing campaign. So UC San Diego is located in La Jolla, California, which is historically very white, very wealthy, very conservative area. And so as part of the campaign to reach more Latinx students, one, they actually did a lot of Spanish-branded media campaigns. Two, they started looking outside of La Jolla. So they started going down to areas like Chula Vista. And three, one of the big things that we wanted to do was make sure that there was storytelling, right? Because storytelling is such a big part of immigrant and Latinx culture particularly. And so one of the stories that they talked about was actually one of our professors named Dr. Olivia Grave, who actually grew up on the border between Tijuana and Chula Vista, and now is an engineering professor and one of the lead engineering professors over at UC San Diego. So the story was told in Spanish, and it was about how there was this young girl that grew up on the border, and there was the image of a butterfly, and how she metamorphosized to become a butterfly and is now a faculty member and a leader, not only over at UC San Diego, but also nationally and internationally as well, right? So Dr. Grave, you know, what she talks about is breaking down borders, and that is one of the things that's very important to her. And so she talks about that in Spanish as part of that media campaign. So I know that that was one of the pieces that we worked on when I was at UC San Diego, in addition to all the great things that are going on with Centro Fox and with Reality Changers.
Great. So Dr. Smith, we're going to turn to the last question and then maybe open it up to the audience. But one of the things that we talked about earlier today, and Dr. Smith kind of alluded to some of the division that's going on in our country, right? We got an election coming up, and you're seeing that played out in the last couple of weeks, and that's going to probably intensify. But what about, we talked a little bit about the divisions sometimes that exist between our communities of color, right? And we talked a little bit about that. Can you share maybe some lessons with our audience about how you deal with some of those divisions? Now granted, the media sometimes overplays those divisions, and I want to acknowledge that, because I can think of multiple examples where we've come together over the years, right? I've been around a little while. Devin mentioned some of my work back in the 70s in Madison, right? All kinds of examples. And of course, in the 80s, I mentioned that I worked with the Rainbow Coalition. That was Jesse Jackson's presidential campaign. And that was a bringing together communities of color, right? So all kinds of examples, right, of where you don't necessarily see divisiveness between our communities of color. But what would, if you do see that played out in San Diego or in Johns Hopkins, what are some lessons to overcome that divisiveness sometimes between our communities, and maybe some of the territoriality that comes with that, right? You know, we have so few crumbs out there. Sometimes you might fight over those crumbs, limited funds and support. But can you speak a little bit about that? I think a couple of you kind of, we talked a little bit about that over lunch.
Well, the first thing I would say is I'm black. I'm a black woman, but I serve predominantly Latino students, East African immigrants. I'm not either of those. But to me, the work doesn't matter. The community that I'm serving matters. And so as I show up in spaces, I get to be the voice for them. And so I'm talking about my students. I never lead with these are my Latino students, or these are my students. And I'm coming to the table as a black woman in the privilege that I have in that. And I'm showing up in these spaces to ruffle some feathers, to pound on some tables for them. So when I go into the rooms, when I'm at Central Fox, it has never come up that, oh, here's Tamara, the black leader from Reality. No, Tamara's coming in because she's an expert in XYZ. And so I think that's part of my modeling for the students, is that your identity is important. I am very proud to be a black woman. But it also means it doors open for me, but then I have a responsibility in that. And so pulling people through those doors and kicking down some doors sometimes has to happen. So when I'm going to these spaces, I'm talking about these students. I try to take the descriptors away from them and teaching my students to control their narrative. You own your narrative. You get to tell your story, because if you don't tell it, somebody's going to tell it. Inevitably, it is not the right story. Even as a leader of an organization, when the George Floyd issue happened, I had to make a decision of what was I going to do as the leader? Do I have a responsibility as the leader of this organization to say something? What voice do I use in that statement? And I struggled with it for a minute. I'll be very honest with you, I struggled, knowing that 99% of my donors are white. Knowing that the universities I represent are white, am I going to ruin the organization by saying what I knew I needed to say in my heart? And so I made the decision that if it affects my students, it affects me. And I took the chance of saying, this is not okay, and I stand with this community. And it had never been done before. Yes, pissed a lot of people off. I lost a couple of donors, but I always told my staff, all money's not good money, and if they're not gonna be supportive of this community, I didn't want their money. And so I think that is the solidarity. So when I show up in Mexico and I don't speak Spanish, but I understand it, so be careful, sometimes I do, I understand it better. I can still walk the walk and talk the talk, even though I'm not a first generation Chicano student. But I understand what needs to happen to support them on these college campuses. So I can go in and push the envelope and push the door open and say, you all are not doing a good enough job of serving these students when they get on campus. We're talking, I just literally this morning had a phone call that one of my Latina students is at a different UC, and she's on food stamps and had run out. And she's in a community, she's not from that area, and had gone hungry for 3 days. Not okay. It's just absolutely not okay. And so the phone calls that I then made this afternoon was like, I bet you better fix it right now. And so that's the kind of responsibility that I feel that I have in doing my hard work, that I get to fight the fight for these students so that they can just go to college.
Thank you for that, Charles. Charles, how about you?
Yeah, so I think for me, it's about reminding folks that it's never really a zero-sum game, right? I'll give a specific example. So when we were over at UC San Diego, and we were on the verge of becoming HSI, and I would speak with folks who were not Latinx, so our students that were Black, or our students that were Asian, or our students that were Indigenous, or our students that were white. And I'd be like, yo, what do you think about this? And they'd be like, well, it doesn't really affect me, right? Like, it's a Hispanic-serving institution. It doesn't have anything to do with me. And I remember, you know, thinking through that and kind of taking it to heart, right? Because if you don't see that this is affecting you, even though you're a part of this institution, then that is a problem. That means that we are not messaging and communicating well enough to you all as students that are not Latinx why this matters to you. And so I think that's where we really thought a little bit more strategically through, like, why does this matter, right? It matters because faculty members are gonna get trained in more culturally competent ways. It matters because the spaces that you're about to get, you know, to be a part of, the facilities that you see, the art that you see around you is going to become more culturally relevant, right? And more culturally responsive. It matters because, you know, language access, right? Not only just in Spanish, but also that as a pinnacle for other languages to come later on, for other Asian students and other, you know, non-English speaking students, it matters. And so all of these are things that stemmed from a Hispanic serving institution type of concept and thought process, but it matters to you all as students, as part of the university, and as stakeholders as part of this university. And so when I think about strategies and tactics in terms of why, you know, cross-cultural unity and solidarity matters, that's one of the big things that I really keep in mind, is that it's never a zero-sum game. And we're always stakeholders in the things that are going on. And that's why it's more vital than ever that we make ourselves aware of what's going on around us so that we can play our part.
Absolutely. Great, great. So we're gonna wrap up with a last question, and then we're gonna open it up to the audience. What can we do now? What can we be doing now in this moment to sustain progress for our communities of color collaboratively through our coalition work? I mentioned before we got the election coming up. You can maybe speak to that, or speak to what's in the future for Reality Changers. What do you hope to do with John Hopkins in your DEI work there? So what does the future look like for both of you?
So, God, that's a lot in that question. That's a lot. Goodness. You know, honestly, if I could work myself out of a job, I'd be happy. I don't think I will, though. And that saddens me, is that you would think that the organization I work with, we're 21 years old, you would think that I still wouldn't have to be doing the same work today. But how do I push the needle, I think, is the future. And we're a locally based organization, been around 21 years, people know about us, but like, this work needs to be in other places. I can't do it all by myself. I have 3,300 alumni. I serve 1,400 students annually with over 600 families, again, all first-generation students, and we've seen the effects. College graduation rates are astronomical, which is great, but it's just not enough. And so this, when it comes to the community that I serve, I get so very passionate about what's happening to them. Getting out to vote, the old phrase, vote like your life depends on it, kind of does. And so, but again, telling that story to the community that I serve, challenging. They're afraid, the fear. So I just tell the story as much as I possibly can and talk about what happens if we don't do this. What happens if we don't change the graduation rates? What happens if we don't help these students find jobs? What happens if we don't get out and vote? And so, not to focus on doom and gloom, but the possibilities if you do vote, the possibilities when you do graduate, the possibilities when you do get that first job. That's the power of what we do. And so our work is not done. I probably would die doing this work, which again, I wish that wasn't the story. So when I see people like Dr. Walker doing this work, it makes me very proud that, we're getting old. Yeah. Older than, I'm younger than I look. I'm just sorry. But to know that I can pass the torch to other people, that we have to have more people doing this work and understanding it does affect you. It does affect the economy. So when I look at my program and I talk to donors and I say, it's not enough just for me to get these kids in college. I got to get them out, but then I got to find them jobs, because when I do, it changes the economy of the city. You're talking about homeowners now, first generation homeowners. You're talking about political figures. That is going to change these communities when you get to change those numbers. And I had someone say, well, this kid graduated and they just went back to run their father's business. They just went back? That's huge. Because imagine what that business is going to do now that you have a student with a college degree who's learned mathematics and business operations. That business is going to thrive in a different way. So there's so many different mindsets that we have to change and work on and talk about, but it starts with these students.
That's right. Thank you for that. Yeah, I feel your pain because I've been doing this work for 40 years, right? But I have hope, right? We saw those spoken word artists. Absolutely. That were here, and that gives me hope, that along with the Devin Walkers that are out there. And so, Charles, how about you? What's on the horizon for your work at Johns Hopkins?
Yeah, I'll keep it brief. So I'm really optimistic. Mm-hmm. I feel really good because our young people, our young folks, so I feel similarly to you where I'm just like, I'm getting old. I definitely don't have like the same energy as I did before. And our young folks, our students, the ones that I've worked with on the East Coast, on the West Coast, in the Southwest, everywhere across the nation really are the most conscious I feel like they've ever been before, right? Like, and they're really looking out for each other. They're really being in unity and in solidarity with each other. And that gives me great hope.
Yes.
And I think as someone who actually oftentimes, can be a little bit skeptical and as someone who, can be a little bit critical at times, that's something that's really important for me to hang on to. Not only just for my own mental health, but also because I really do believe that, there is change and that there is progress on the way. And for me, I'll always remember Jack Ma, who used to be the CEO of Alibaba, talked about once you reach a certain age, you really look forward to young folks and let them pave the way, and you're really just there to support, right? And help in whatever capacity you can. And I really very much so believe in that and adhere to that. So I have great hope for the future, for solidarity and cross-cultural unity. Among our young folks and for the future.
Excellent. Thank you so much. So I'm going to turn to my MC, Devin. How much time do we got? Can we take a couple of questions from the audience?
Yeah,
we've
got about two questions worth.
All right, two questions worth.
Two questions.
So let's hear from the audience. Can't really see you out there, but any questions from the audience? Can we? We got mics up here, and we got somebody stepping up. Can you start with your name?
Kevin Washington. I'm a senior here and I study international relations and global studies. And my question is kind of like a two-part question built in one. And it says, in what ways does language acquisition help to strengthen cross-cultural unity And also, how has it helped you in your professional career, or what have you noticed about its benefits?
Let's take that.
Yeah, so first off, I love two-pronged questions because I always only remember one. So you'll probably have to help me remember. So I'll try answering, and if I miss anything, then one of us can fill in. So language acquisition. So I actually think that it's pivotal, right, and vital to building cross-cultural solidarity. I think some of my favorite sayings are actually in Spanish that I remember. And I actually think that, you know, when you know multiple languages, there's actually certain things that you can't necessarily express, mm-hmm. right, in English. And so for me, I think that being able to translate that across different languages is particularly important. I also think that, you know, again, sharing my own experience as an immigrant, as someone who didn't learn English until the age of four, being able to be fluent in English has been extremely important, not only for me and for my own education, but also for my family. Because of language acquisition, I'm able to advocate for things for my family in ways that I couldn't. I'm able to, you know, ask for things, request things, at times demand things in ways that my parents would never dream about doing, right? Just because they still have the mindset that they're an immigrant in this country and that they don't own things the way that folks who are American or folks who were born here do. So to me, language access and acquisition is actually extremely important to build cross-cultural unity, but also solidarity across different communities and to build, you know, build an equitable society.
So I would say that the language is very important. So no, I don't speak fluent Spanish, and I'm going to work on that. I'm committed to that. But I try. I go in with the basics. So I think the community respects that I at least come to the table with, I'm trying. I just, on the last trip I went to Mexico, one of the professors from UC San Diego, he's actually from Spain, and his wife is from Russia. And so he only speaks to his children in Spanish, and she only speaks to them in Russian. And then the parents speak to each other in English. And then as the children got older, by the time they went to school, and so I think about what is that going to do for those kids that they will have three languages? Mm-hmm. We're probably one of the only countries that people only speak one language, like at home. So being in a multicultural world, I think it only gives us a step further if we can actually embrace language in a different way.
Can I actually add on to that really quickly? Mm-hmm. So I think one of the things that's important to address is policy, right? So specific to language and policy, when I was at UC San Diego, and this was in the thick of the pandemic, so everything moved virtual and like people didn't really know what was going on, right? We actually had a case where it was a set of twins and they were accused of cheating. And basically the professor was like, yeah, you know, based off of like when your answers came in and how similar they were, like, I know that you cheated. And they were my students, and my students were like, no, we didn't cheat. And in fact, like, our mom was with us, right, at home. We were in separate rooms. We did not have a way to communicate to each other. And so therefore, you know, she knows that we didn't cheat. So then when it went to student conduct, the student conduct policy was like, okay, cool, like, your mom can come as a witness. And they were like, yeah, but my mom only speaks Spanish, right? So is that cool? And as you can probably see where this is going, they were like, sorry, we don't have translators. Like, there's no way that they're able to, like, she basically can't serve as a witness to you unless she can attest in English at the student conduct hearing that that's, you know, that basically you all didn't cheat. And so this was actually gonna be okay. And then, you know, because they were my students, I caught wind of it. And it reminded me so much of my own story that I was just pissed. Like, I don't even know how else to say it. Like, I was just angry that they were not allowed to be a part of a student conduct hearing where everyone else who speaks English fluently is able to be a part of that. And I was like, yeah, no, this policy needs to change. And so we were able to bring that up. And eventually, you know, as you may know, academia moves pretty slowly, but we were able to eventually get that policy changed. And so I think that's, you know, a really strong example of when language acquisition, you know, influences policy, and policy needs to be able to be equitable in how folks are able to you know, to have equity in language.
Great. Did you have a second part to your question? What was what's that?
They answered it.
Okay, very good.
Thank you so much.
All right.
Thank you.
We got time for one more question, Devin. We have somebody wants to ask our panelists a question.
Sure. A quick question.
All right. Here we go. Here we go.
Good evening. My name is Deal Marvelous in sophomore. I'm an economics major at the University of Texas at Austin and also a proud ambassador of the Heman Sweat Center.
Nice.
And as my current job on campus as a mentor and my side job as an apartment locator and realtor, I'm finding it increasingly hard to find affordable housing for students, especially my students, which I take care of very dearly. And the university has been slow in making changes, adjusting to the rising housing prices in Austin. So as, you know, thinking about different groups on campus and where students are becoming more verbal about said issue, how would you guys advise for, or what angle would you guys advise for us to, you know, engage in this discussion with the university, since the problem is much larger than the university alone?
So that was something that we were definitely facing at UC San Diego, where unfortunately we had students that were like commuting in from LA, or like sleeping in their cars because the housing around La Jolla was just so inaccessible. I know that UC San Diego has done a number of things to be able to address that. So they've literally like purchased real estate in the surrounding areas and been able to offer at subsidized rates to students. But just to be very real with you, it remains an ongoing issue. I think what I would say in terms of advice is basically the same advice that I gave to my students with the JHPD issue, right? Which is don't stop the communication. So basically when I was speaking with the leaders of the BSU over the JHPD issue, they were like, Dr. Liu, like, we're never going to be for the JHPD, right? And so we had a new vice president of campus safety that wanted to meet with them and engage in conversations. And they were like, why? Like, why? Well, why would we talk to him when we know that he's for the JHPD and this unit reports to him and we already know where we stand with this? And what I said was like, yeah, sure, you could not talk to him and you could not engage with the vice president, but is that really productive, right? Is this really gonna move the needle forward in any sort of way? And so similarly, what I would say is that, you know, with this particular issue, which is an issue that is, you know, also at UC San Diego and other places as well, and I hear you and I feel you, it's very much so a real issue. My advice to you is to not stop the conversation and to continue meeting with and talking with leadership here at the university who, you know, will try to work with you as much as possible. And let them know what's going on with students, right? And be transparent with them.
And I would add, don't forget about the community. Mm-hmm. Community housing, those are nonprofits that focus on that type of work also. Tap into them, because they also have additional resources and connections that you can also take advantage of.
That's right. There's a lot of organizations that are out there fighting that battle, right? Because it's not just students that are getting affected by those policies, right? They're state and city policies. So, for example, the Austin Tenants Council, I believe, you might want to reach out to them. They're an organization that's been doing that work for years, supporting renters. So perhaps they might have some ideas that they can share with you. But certainly, you know, it's a city council you got to step, get in front of, right? And there may be some allies on that student council that you can get their ear and talk to those allies and express your concern, right? You've got some students already organizing around that issue and make a visit with some of those council members. I know a couple of them, be happy to share their names with you. But also, to Tamara's point, there's some community organizations that are out there fighting that battle. And so don't do it alone, right? It's not just you fighting that battle over rent control, over the rising prices of rent, right? So keep at it and keep fighting. So I think we're going to wrap up. We're going to close out the program with some awards. So thank you, everybody. Let's give our panelists a hand.
I want to thank you all for the wonderful discussion, but also just telling us what the consequences if we don't work together, but also the possibilities of what happens when we do. So we are at the point of the program where we get to honor students that have worked cross-collaboratively and have been intentional in their work in supporting their communities and this university. But this year, we are going to actually also honor faculty and staff. And so, as I just said, in recent years, we have honored students and student organizations with something called the Human Sweat Legacy Award. And these students have made significant contributions to diversity and equity and inclusion or civil rights on our campus or within our community. And this year, we are going to honor faculty and staff along with students because we have so many faculty and staff members that are working in academic fields, they're doing research on civil rights, or their staff that are leading campus and community civil rights efforts. And so we knew that it was time to, like we honor our students, we need to honor our faculty and staff. And so it is my pleasure that this year I get to announce our first Faculty Legacy Award honoree to Dr. John Moran Gonzalez. Dr. Gonzalez is the J. Frank Dobie Regents Professor of American and English Literature at UT Austin. Hailing from Brownsville, Texas, Dr. Gonzalez graduated from Princeton and Stanford Universities, and as a leading scholar of American literature, he has written and edited a number of books, including The Troubled Union, An Expansionist Imperatives in Post-Reconstruction American Novels, and The Cambridge Companion to Latina and Latino American Literature. In addition, Dr. Gonzalez is a founding member of the Refusing to Forget, which is a nonprofit public history project specifically dedicated to critically memorializing state violence in South Texas, especially the borderlands that occurred between 1910 and 1920. Founded in 2014, RTF has been recognized as a leader in the field of public memory studies and activism. He is the former director of the Center for Mexican American Studies, and he currently serves as the acting director for Plan 2 Honors Program. Please join me in congratulating Dr. Gonzalez for the inaugural Human Sweat Faculty Legacy Award. All right, well, we're gonna go over and now honor two students. I want to introduce the first student honoree, Marilyn Nuara. She's an undergraduate majoring in public health, and as a student athlete, she was instrumental in establishing the community co-sponsorship program, called Longhorns for Equity, Access, and Diversity, affectionately known as LEAD. It's a partnership between Texas Athletics and the Division of Diversity and Community Engagement. And through her leadership, student athletes have supported multiple nonprofits who provide critical services to diverse populations across the state of Texas. And outside of her work with LEAD, she works with Texas Athletics Pre-Health Organization. She's the Black President's Leadership Council and is on the leadership team of the Longhorn Christian Fellowship. She is bilingual and provides Spanish language support to nonprofits and is also an active volunteer with the Dell Children's Hospital, where she spends time with children in the mental health facility. To sum up, as quoted by her nominator, Marilyn is a dynamic student activist and a fierce advocate, not just for her community on campus, but for all disenfranchised communities in Central Texas. So please join me in honoring and congratulating Marilyn Nuara.
Thank you.
All right, so our second student honoree is also very dynamic. Parker Curlew is an undergraduate student majoring in psychology and a student staff member at the Gender and Sexuality Center. She is a crucial member of the Black, Queer, and Trans Collective, a mental health ambassador, and a representative for the GSC and the Be That One program at many events across campus. As her nomination said, like Heman Sweat, Parker is a groundbreaker. She stands up for queer and trans BIPOC students in many spaces, demonstrating grace under fire. She has displayed courage and tenacity when she's the only Black queer woman in a room and has created a space for herself and other Black queer students where they can both survive and thrive at this university. So Parker, please come up and get your award and help me in congratulating Parker Curlew. And last, but certainly not least, the Staff Legacy Award goes to Dr. Ryan Sutton. Dr. Sutton is an Assistant Dean for Diversity, Equity, and Inclusion at Dell Medical School. And prior to joining Dell Med, Dr. Sutton served as the Director of the Heman Sweat Center for Black Males and Community Integrated Health Initiative within the Division of Diversity and Community Engagement. In these roles, he was instrumental in developing and implementing programming and services that enrich the educational experience of so many of our underrepresented students. In addition to his role at Dell Med, he holds an assistant professor of practice appointment at UT Macomb School of Business and the College of Education, where he teaches classes and holds trainings on topics such as psychological assessment, mental health, health equity, and implicit bias. Dr. Sutton, congratulations on receiving the Heman Sweat Inaugural Staff Legacy Award. Congratulations to each of our Heman Sweat Legacy Award honorees for their dedication and their efforts to civil rights across campus, the community, and the state. I want to hand it back over to you, Dr. Walker.
Thank you. Can we give it up for our awardees one more time, huh? Congratulations. And last up, we have a friend of mine who I've known for years. She's a UT alum. I've known her since her first year, and now she is a colleague. Sydney Cox is a program coordinator for the Fearless Leadership Institute, and she is going to bless us with a song called Rise Up.
Broken down and tired of living life on a merry-go-round, and you can't find a fighter, but I see it in you, so we gon' walk it out and move mountains. We gon' walk it out and move mountains. I'll rise up, I'll rise like the day. I'll rise up, I'll rise unafraid. I'll rise up, and I'll do it 1,000 times again. We'll rise up, high like the waves. We'll rise up, in spite of the ache. We'll rise up, and we'll do it 1,000 times again. For you, 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 for you. When the silence isn't quiet and it feels like it's getting hard to breathe, and I know you feel like dying, but I promise we'll bring the world to its feet and move mountains. Bring it to its feet and move mountains. We'll rise up, we'll rise like the day. We'll rise up, we'll rise unafraid. We'll rise up and we'll do it 1,000 times again. And for you, we have each other, and for that we have each other. Hey, we will rise, we will rise, so we will rise. Oh, oh, oh. We'll rise, and we'll rise up, rise like the day. We'll rise up, we'll rise unafraid. We'll rise 1,000 times again. And we'll rise up, rise like the day. We'll rise up, we'll rise unafraid. We'll rise up 1,000 times again. I'm singing for you.
Sydney, 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 Miss Day. Miss Day, better watch out. Came for her song. I thank you for that inspirational performance. It was a beautiful ending to a wonderful night. I want to close with a quote from Strength to Love sermon from Dr. Martin Luther King Jr. Dr. King said that the ultimate measure of a man is not where he stands in moments of comfort and convenience, but where he stands at times of challenge and controversy, and that the true neighbor will risk his position, his prestige, and even his life for the welfare of others. And so I want you all, as you leave today, I want to ask you where you are going to stand. I want to thank everybody that has been with us this evening, and I hope that you will be able to join us for the reception that will be held in the lobby upstairs. And again, I want to give a warm welcome or warm applause for all of our honorees, our performers, and our panelists. So thank you, and good night. You can bring the house lights up, and if I can get the panelists, honorees, and performers to join me on stage for a quick photo.